Hey everyone, it's good to be with you today. Robin here from Lincoln Avenue Baptist Church. You might notice I'm wearing my Batman t-shirt today. So, hey, today you got Batman and Robin. I'm feeling a little silly, I'm sorry, I apologize for that, but it's no charge, at least, right? Okay. You know, lately I've been thinking a bit about Jesus in the Old Testament, right? Jesus is everywhere in the Old Testament once you start looking for him there. And we'll look at a particular passage in just a little bit, but I just want to say Jesus is everywhere from Genesis all the way to Malachi, the last book, which is like was written like 400 years before Jesus came. So he's really close to when Jesus came. And Jesus is everywhere in between. Someone has said that history is actually his story. It all points to Jesus. Of course, Jesus was veiled. He was in the shadows in the Old Testament. People had little pieces of the puzzle. Maybe you've put a crossword puzzle together before, and if you didn't have that picture there, you wouldn't know what it would look like. And the thing is, God is the one that's putting the puzzle together for us. And people would have little bitty pieces of the puzzle. They would say, hey, Jesus or the Messiah is going to be our only hope. We find that in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, when God pronounces a curse on Satan and says that through the offspring of the woman, one will come who will crush or bruise the head of the serpent. And like I said, that was in the shadows. But people, they could still hope in the Messiah now. They didn't know exactly. They could believe God's word, right? And so they did that. Many of them did that. And as time went on, they would see more pieces of the puzzle. And they began to put some of this together, where Jesus would be born, what tribe he would be born into, and how he would be a king that would rule forever. Injustice, and he would be set on the throne of David, right? And so all these pieces of the puzzle began to come together, but he was still in the shadows. But they did know that they were told, and they could have confidence in God and in his promised Messiah who was coming, because Adam and Eve sinned, right? And so they needed someone else to do for them what they could not do. They came to God the same way we do today, through Jesus. They hoped in the Messiah. They believed God's word. They didn't have the full picture, but they were saved by grace through faith, just like we are. But we can look back to what Jesus has did for us in our life. And so the Old Testament is full of Jesus. And he was shown to the people in the Old Testament in many, many different ways, actually. I mean, today we are Monday morning quarterbacks, and we have the Holy Spirit, if you know Christ. So we have his help in seeing Jesus in the Old Testament. We see him in the law. We see him in the genealogies as a record from Adam all the way to Jesus. And we see him in the genealogies in that God made the promise of the Messiah to people, many people, who were the ancestors of Jesus. He made the promise to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, in the Messiah, or in their offspring, all of the world would be blessed. That would be every nation, tribe, and tongue, right? And he made the promise to others in his lineage, people like David and Solomon, even evil King Ahaz. He was in the lineage of Jesus. And God said this to him in Isaiah 7:14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. So this is quoted in the New Testament around the time when Jesus was born. So this is a prophecy about Jesus. And then we also see Jesus played out in the lives of people. I mean, God's amazing the way that he can show us the coming Messiah in the lives of people as they live out their everyday life. People like Abraham and Isaac. Remember, God asked Abraham to sacrifice Isaac in the same area of the world where on a mountain where Jesus was crucified. And like Jesus carried his own cross, Isaac carried his own, the wood for the sacrifice up the mountain. And we see this beautiful picture of Jesus played out in the lives of Abraham and Isaac. Jesus is seen in Isaac as a type, but also in the ram that was caught in the thicket. That's Jesus, our substitution. And I think, personally, also in the angel of the Lord that stopped Abraham from sacrificing Isaac. Because the angel of the Lord usually refers to, we believe, many believe, is that is Jesus in the Old Testament because he accepts worship. But nevertheless, Jesus is throughout this picture, and the picture as a whole points us to Jesus Christ and how he was the perfect sacrifice. He was the only one who could pay the wages of our sin for us and give us his righteousness. He was the Lamb without spot and blemish. So we see these stories played out in the lives of people throughout the Old Testament. People like Noah and David and Jonah, even Samson to some degree, how he, one man, gave his life to save a whole tribe or the whole of Israel. So we see this over and over. We see, who was it? Enoch, I think the seventh from Adam in the Old Testament, he prophesied even about Jesus. Actually, it was about Jesus' second coming. So Jesus is throughout the Old Testament. Today, I want us to look at Proverbs 8, and hopefully briefly, I'll try not to keep it too long. You may remember in the book of Proverbs, from time to time, a couple women pop their heads up. One is the virtuous woman, or she's the lady wisdom, right? And then there's also the adulterous woman, the prostitute, the evil woman, the wicked woman, right? And so both of them are always out calling the children of men to come to them. We find them out on the highways and byways and at the city gates, everywhere. In town, out of town, everywhere, on the hills. And so today we're going to look at the Lady Wisdom in Proverbs chapter 8 and see how we might see Jesus in this proverb. Let me just begin, and I'll try to be brief with some of this, but we're going to look for similarities between the Lady Wisdom in Proverbs and Jesus. Okay, Proverbs 8, verse 1. Does not wisdom call? Does not understanding raise her voice? Verse 4. To you, O men, I call, and my cry is to the children of men. So, does Jesus call men, right? We're starting off basic here, right? Could this be a picture of Jesus? Does Jesus call people to himself? Of course he does. Many times. Matthew 11:28 is one. And Jesus said, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. All right. So let's go on down to verse 8. And here's what it says. Proverbs chapter 8. All the verses point us to Jesus, I think, in this chapter. But we don't have time for all of them. So we're looking at a few. Here's what it says. All the words of my mouth are righteous. There is nothing twisted or crooked in them. Does that sound like anyone you know? We already talked about it, right? Jesus is the only righteous one. Adam and Eve and you and I were not righteous. But Jesus was the only one who is righteous. And 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus offers his righteousness to you, and he paid the wages of our sin on the cross. All right, well, verse 11 in Proverbs 8 says, "For wisdom is better than jewels, and all that you may desire cannot compare with her." So, what about Jesus? Well, if you know Jesus, you know he's the greatest treasure in the universe, worth leaving all for, abandoning everything with great joy. That's in Matthew chapter 13, 44, I believe. Or Colossians 2, 3, speaking of Christ, says this, "In whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." Yeah, I mean, Jesus is our treasure, folks. Better than jewels, just like wisdom, right? Great. Moving on down to verse 17, Proverbs 8. "I love those who love me, and those who seek me diligently find me." That reminds me of, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." "Seek and you shall find," Jesus said. Yeah, let me read that verse again. "I love those who love me, and those who seek me diligently find me." All right. Verse 21, Proverbs chapter 8 says, "Granting an inheritance to those who love me and filling their treasuries." So we talked about the treasures that we find in Jesus, and just like wisdom, wisdom says that she grants an inheritance, right, to people who come to her. But we find that this is true with Jesus as well. What does it say about Jesus? One place among many is in Ephesians. Let's see, I think it's Ephesians chapter 1, I think, verse 18. It says, and Paul wanted the people in Ephesus to know this about God. And here's what he says, quote, "What are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints?" So Jesus himself said, all things are ours. We're the children of God. We have an inheritance laid up for us that we can look forward to. We don't look forward to this world, right? It's full of brokenness, and it winds up ending in death. I mean, God gives us blessings along the way, yes, but our hope is in him. All the blessings we get here should help us to glorify God and rejoice in God for who he is. So next in Proverbs 8:25, Solomon begins a longer passage. I'm going to read some of it here. I'll read one verse and then a bigger portion of it, and we'll finish up Proverbs chapter 8 pretty quick. But he gives us a different perspective on the Lady Wisdom. It's kind of interesting, I think. It continues to point us to Jesus, all right? Let me read beginning in verse 25. "Before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth." Okay, so this reminds me how Jesus comes forth with God and as God. He is God, right? From outside of time and space, and begins setting up these laws like gravity, right? and all the things related to nature and the universe in creation. So again, before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. So that's wisdom talking, right? And of Jesus, speaking of Jesus, we find in Colossians chapter 1, beginning with verse 15, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together." So that's talking about Jesus, right? So Jesus was there before the mountains had been shaped in the hills, just like wisdom. And let's continue on with Proverbs 8:26. Before he had made the earth with its fields, or the first of the dust of the world. Remember, this is wisdom talking. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep. When he made from the skies. When he made firm the skies above. When he established the fountains of the deep. When he assigned to the sea its limit, so that waters might not transgress his command. When he marked out the foundations of the earth. Then I was beside him like a master workman, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always. So who is this one being described here that's like a master workman in creation? Who is this? Who is with God and also who rejoiced in God and God rejoiced in him? And who was God's delight in creation, right? Jesus, right? I'm reminded of when God said, let us make man in our image, right? So that's God. He's one God in three persons, the Trinity. That we see it there. And the Holy Spirit was there, right, in creation. Genesis 1:26, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the water. So we see Jesus right away in Genesis, right? And he is the beloved of the Father, daily his delight in creation with the Holy Spirit there. So I think this in Proverbs 8 is just pointing us, like everything else in the Old Testament, to Jesus. It pretty much lines up also with John chapter 1. Let me read a little bit of that before we close and see if you don't see Jesus in Proverbs 8 and how it parallels. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And then down to verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. So to me, that seems like it's clearly wisdom in Proverbs chapter 8 is referring to and pointing us to Jesus, who was there with God, and he was a master workman with God in creation. And so just to close out Proverbs chapter 8, let's see here. Remember, wisdom, he calls, like wisdom calls the children of men. Jesus is calling men to himself. Remember that as I read this. And now, O sons, listen to me. Lady Wisdom is talking, okay? Blessed are those who keep my ways. Hear instruction and be wise and do not neglect it. Blessed is the one who listens to me, watching daily at my gates, waiting beside my doors, for whoever finds me finds life and obtains favor from the Lord. But he who fails to find me injures himself. All who hate me love death. So Jesus is the life. He's the way, truth, and the life. Whoever finds him finds life, right? And whoever doesn't find Jesus finds death. True, right? And Jesus is still calling us today, calling us to find favor with God. It's a call to have new life in Christ. It's a call to keep on watching at the gate, seeking to see more of the glory of God in Jesus, even after we've come to Christ, because he's the greatest treasure in the universe, right? If you know Christ, you know that. And so you never quit seeking to see more of him. But for those who will not listen, as Lady Wisdom said in Proverbs 8, it's like eternal death away from all that is good. Now, I just want to close out today with a little poem that I wrote about this chapter, and then we'll pray, all right? Long before valleys low, mountains high, and hills, or grain of dust on earth was thrust to occupy the fields, I was before him filled with joy, and he was pleased with me. 'Twas all good, with no beginning, one God in three. So when he marked and drew a circle, I too was there. And when he made the heavens, all this I shared. He steadied the sky and established the deep. He set boundaries for waters. They all heard him speak. He marked out the earth. I offered my hand. In God's own image created we man. My father sent me to earth, and I willingly went. To the world I created, now broken and bent. I was paid wages for their hatred and their sin. For their good I lived, died, and rose again. Yet it was for God's glory, his praise, and his name that he chose you and made you, that his only son came. This good news of great joy for the human race is all to the praise of his glorious grace. Father God, thank you for your word today, Lord, and thank you for showing us Jesus and for giving Jesus, your only begotten Son, so that we might have hope and new life in Christ and his righteousness. Thank you, Lord, that you gave us this hope even after we rebelled and called you a liar. Even after Adam and Eve followed after Satan, and then all their descendants were born out of your fellowship, Father. And thank you for allowing us to come back into your acceptance through your promised Messiah. And all those, the saints of old who look forward to your coming, Lord, thank you for them. And that we who now believe will be with them one day, Lord. And it's all about you, though, Lord, throughout the Old Testament, And in the New Testament, and in the ages to come, Lord, it's all about you. It's for your glory. And only when you are exalted and you are held up high as you really are, Father, only then do we receive, only then can we receive your gift in acknowledging you as supreme in our life. Over and above any of our own self-centered will, Father. Help us to look to you as our only hope. And thank you for your forgiveness. And help us to grow in you, Lord. And help us to delight in you and the righteousness of Jesus and share your glory with others so that all the world may know you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. I'll play a little music for you now, okay?
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Sing it with me now. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside your garments that are stained with sin, and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you in the blood of the Lamb?
All right.
They tell me of a home far beyond the sky. Oh, they tell me of a home far away. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, the land of a cloudless day. Of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. They tell me that he smiles on his children there, and his smile drives their sorrows all away. And they tell me that no tears ever come again in that lovely land of unclouded day. Oh, the land of a cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day.
Well, some come crippled and some come lame, but we all come broken, jumping and dancing in Jesus' name. Walking in Jerusalem just like John, you made me ready, stable and steady. And you were ready, Lord, to walk in Jerusalem just like John. He will carry us there,
upon his shoulder, all who delight in God's own Son. I'll meet you there at the first crossover, to walk in Jerusalem just like John. You make me ready, stable and steady. Yeah, you were ready, Lord, to walk in Jerusalem just like John. Well, if you get there before I do, cross and the battle won, tell all my friends I'm a-coming too, to walk in Jerusalem just like John. Well, but while I'm here, every day, this is what I dwell upon, abide in you, your word, and pray, till I walk in Jerusalem just like John. You make me ready, stable and steady, and you were ready, Lord, to walk in Jerusalem just like John. Well, Joshua fought the battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Oh, Joshua fought the battle of Jericho, and the walls came tumbling down, 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 right up to the walls of Jericho that circle around the town. Oh, Joshua commanded the children to shout, and the walls came tumbling down. You know what? This world is full of giants, monsters, fiend and foe. Mountains tall are sure to fall, like the walls of Jericho. Well, the promised land waits up ahead. Who will let the lost man know? Who will trust God to break down the wall, like the battle of Jericho? Joshua fought the battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Oh, Joshua fought the battle of Jericho, and the walls came tumbling down, 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 down.
All right, one day Jesus will return, and hey, there will be no more brokenness, no more broken world, right? We'll be with the Lord.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Sing it with me.
Safe and secure from all alarms, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Secure from all alarms, leaning on the everlasting arms. When Israel was in Egypt's land, poorly treated so, oppressed so hard they could not stand, God heard their cries of woe. The Lord spoke from the fiery bush, and he told Moses to go. Moses said, please send another, for my speech is slow. Go down, Moses, way down to Egypt's land. Tell-o, Pharaoh, to let my people go. So Moses went to Egypt land, let my people go. He made old Pharaoh understand, let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down to Egypt's land. Tell old Pharaoh to let my people go. Thus spoke the Lord, bold Moses said, let my people go. If not, I'll smite your firstborns dead. Let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down to Egypt's land. Tell old Pharaoh to let my people go.
Next song is Grace Greater Than Our Sin. And if you know Christ, then you've experienced his grace. It was nothing that you did to deserve his grace. No grace is free. And as a believer, isn't it a great thing that we can look forward to God's grace every day of our life? We have victory because of his grace today. It's not because of our works today, even in our life. Yes, he quickens us and he motivates good works in us because he helps us to love others and love God and love God's word. But it's not us. We're not dependent on ourselves. So God's grace is a wonderful, wonderful blessing, a wonderful gift from God. Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Dark is the stain that we cannot hide. What can avail to wash it away? Look, there is flowing a crimson tide, whiter than snow you may be today. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see His face, will you this moment His grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Thanks, everybody. I appreciate the time I had to spend with you today, and I'm looking forward to next month already. God bless you.